All right, and we're live here at Portland Retro Gaming Expo 2017 with some pre-pool friendlies here for Smash 64. My name is TJ Stinson, owner of Epic Gaming, and I'll be your host here early on for this this pool section. I'll be joined later by two much more experienced commentators for the top eight cut that'll happen tonight at 7 p.m. But right now, number one seed Prism on the right here is practicing with another gentleman. So enjoy, and check in a little bit.
Free for all! No contest.
Captain Marvel!
Welcome to Smash a PRGE. This is our round one of pools between Tom Bombadil, hometown favorite, and Kyle Wilson. These matches are best of three. Excuse the darkness in here. This arcade has the lights pulled down so you can play arcade machines easier. But we can still see the players' faces.
Donkey Kong. Donkey Kong.
I can hear you a little bit.
Oh, there we go.
All right, so here we are at the Portland Retro Game Expo, right? Hosted by Epic Games.
Yeah, super excited. You got a big tournament here, like 35 entrants or something?
It is, yeah. It looks like we have a lot of people, which should be pretty exciting. Of course, we're just doing pools right now, and later on, top eight. So for those of you who don't know, if you're a Portland local, Epic Gaming runs a weekly on Sundays at 12, right? And Prism and I come out to that every week with some other guys. So be sure to make it out and we can get Oregon going.
We have Doug Masters and Leo Garcia. Random stage.
I'm not sure if random is tournament legal, but perhaps they gentlemen's to it. So we got a classic matchup here, right? These two are pretty close together on the tier lists historically. Mario a little bit lower, but a lot of people think the matchup actually does favor Mario. But you are a Yoshi main, Prism. What do you think about this matchup?
Well, I'm not a great Yoshi main, but I think Yoshi's got the upper hand here.
Oh, yeah?
Back airs are a good way to wall out Mario. But Mario's got some tricky stuff too. Alright, switching over to Dreamland.
That's right, I mean, whenever you're looking at a Yoshi matchup, you're looking at drill attacks, right? Like things that can get around his parry. And so Mario definitely has drill attacks. We'll see if Doug Masters can get that going. Oh, my apologies, Doug Masters is the Yoshi.
All we got from Yoshi so far is some down Bs.
I mean, you gotta make your opponent fear you early on, right? That's the only strategy, I think. Nothing wrong with a down B tech chase.
It is a powerful move. He's got the up smash to the platform there.
Oh.
There we go.
Are we calling that the double jump armor down B counter? Combatants just dancing around each other right now, you know? See, in free-for-all, I think down B is quite a strong move. That was the Hyrule special, right, back in the day?
Yeah, right.
But in 1v1, a lot of people find it doesn't really have as much of a place. We'll see if Leo Garcia can prove him wrong here.
You gotta bait your opponent into coming up after you, right before you down B. Works as a great mix-up.
Right, so actually, it is worth mentioning that the random down B, or seemingly random, you know, random in quotes, is sort of the patented Wizrobe, who a lot of people think is one of the best Yoshis even in the world. You have any thoughts on using down B like Wizrobe does?
I get away with it often enough to where it's a bad habit, sure.
So maybe one thing I'd like to point out that I didn't realize for a while is when you're talking about the Wizrobe down B, a lot of time you're thinking about Yoshi recovering, and then when his armor is gone, he does the down B because he's scared that he's going to get hit off stage, right? And he doesn't have an up B recovery.
Right.
And so a lot of times what the down B is actually aiming to do is not bait your opponent, but just to get you to land so that you get your jump back and you get that armor.
Get another chance to survive.
Right. And I think once you think about it that way, it makes a lot more sense.
Yeah, it can also be used to drop to the ledge really quick. It'll automatically grab the ledge so there's no landing lag.
Right, and that's quite powerful, both in mixing up your recovery and in edge guarding your opponent, right?
Four tilt. Wasn't able to finish it off.
Leo just gives him the fist. Oh, he's starting to learn how to play around that down B spam with the shield grab. Of course, there's a lot of shield stun in 64, but there are more ending frames on Yoshi's down B. So, as we see, he has punished him twice with that so far. And he gave him the fist for an edge guard.
Nice forward.
Got a little bit of a game going on, huh?
Oh, that was almost a combo. That is a true combo, forward smash spike, stage spike into down B. You gotta be a little faster than that there. Nice up smash.
It's a big up smash. And, Doug Masters pops off.
Yeah, Yoshi's head just about as big as Mario's head during up smash.
Now, I'm not sure if it was needed there, but of course, up smash is one of the moves that you can jump cancel out of shield, so it's possible to do a parry up smash, which makes it very strong if your opponent slips up on their shield pressure. I know that's something that you utilize quite a bit in our matches.
It is useful.
And there we see it poking through the side platform, even from the ground. It's quite a strong move. Going for the fireball edge guard. Can be pretty spicy if you get it.
Whips on the forward smash.
There's that first
time to do an up smash.
Right, yeah.
I don't know if it would kill with super armor, but do quite a bit of damage here.
I think at about 180%, Mario's up smash is going to kill, yeah.
Even with super armor?
I am pretty confident that up smash would break super armor, yeah. Maybe you wouldn't top screen them. It would be interesting, though. Ah, see, this is a real thing that's going on right now from Leo Garcia. With Mario, a lot of time, if you get that down air early enough, even on a short hop, you can get another aerial, like a nair or an up air in. But if you don't get it off in time, a lot of people have been just doing that down B lately. It's reasonably hard to DI out of, and you have to worry about DIing off stage. It's pretty annoying.
Lost his jump there.
Also, it looks like Leo Garcia is making a comeback. He has learned how to deal with this down B spam and making Doug Masters really pay for it. But now we have a game. Will this 4% lead be enough, do you think? So generally after a couple forward tilts like that at low percent, it's good to try to get the dash attack, right? Especially if you can get like a weak dash attack.
Yeah, that'll definitely push them towards the edge, possibly set up for a forward air.
That's really the Yoshi's dream, right? Oh, and the up smash is gonna take it, yeah. Leo Garcia is happy about that one, as he should be. Guys, so Prism is just popping away for a second, and I will take that opportunity to give you some biased comments about how you should play Yoshi from a non-Yoshi player. That should be nice and triggering. Oh, he's back. Uh-oh. Maybe I'll just pose it as a question then. So I got a question for you.
Yeah.
Or how about this instead? We'll do like, it's like in high school where you have you get an essay and you have to do a response to a statement, right?
Okay.
So tell me your response to this statement. Yoshi should almost always down smash or up smash whenever he thinks forward smash is good. That's my belief. If they're behind you, you should up smash. If they're in front of you, you should down smash. Comments?
Yeah, that's pretty good. You're thinking of both characters being on the ground.
Well, mainly what I'm just thinking is I sort of jokingly say that Yoshi forward smash is the worst move in the game. Not because it's actually the worst move, but because it's the worst good move, and so people use it, and it's just bad enough that it's like, you know, it costs them stuff, right?
Right.
So they'll use it on edge guards when they really should be doing something else, and
yeah.
It costs a lot of stock, so that's why I, you know, jokingly call it the worst move. And so my, you know, my biased non-Yoshi main view here is that, you know, if you're trying to do some kind of edge guarding or something, and they're in front of you, then go for the down smash, and if they're, you know, if they're rolling or something, just go for the up smash, not the forward smash, things like that.
Yeah, forward smash definitely has a lot of startup lag, so it doesn't come out really quick, though it is a powerful move. Whereas up smash and down smash are both just as strong, but don't have that laggy startup.
Right, they do come out much quicker.
And down smash will send your opponent more horizontally as opposed to vertically.
Right, that's a great point. You know, if you get a Falcon off stage at low percent and you get a down smash on them, no amount of stage jazz is gonna save them, right?
Right.
But with a forward smash, they might have one more chance. Though of course it must be said that forward smash has much better range than down smash, right? So it's easier to go for a forward smash edge guard sort of safely in quotes than a down smash edge guard. You find that to be the case?
Sorry, what was that?
I was just saying that I think you know, because of the range that forward smash has, a lot of time it is safer, you know, especially against people like Mario who have upbees with really good hitboxes.
Right, yeah, that hitbox will certainly extend a lot further out and possibly hit Mario out of his upbee even without getting hit by the upbee.
That's right. Though it should be said that for most moves, you extend the hitbox, you're also extending your own hurtbox, right? The reason that some of the great aerials are so good is because they don't have this property.
Yeah.
A lot of attacks is you're trying to reach for your opponent makes it easier for them to reach you as well.
He's getting a lot of these forward tilts. Doesn't look like he's really sure what to do with it afterwards.
He does like these tilts though, a lot of forward tilts, and he just caught Leo Garcia with an up tilt there. Of course, tilts are staples of high level play, so this is a good sign for Dub Masters.
Oh, that'll kill.
Maybe the air camp Yoshi should be done this way, right? He's got to bait them and then go for that down B. It's unbeatable.
It's great as your only neutral option. But yeah, it seems to be working out so far.
Three in a row is not bad, but if he gets anything right there, Yoshi has no jump. And, ooh, that fireball was almost it. You know?
Oh.
And that's a bad push-off. You gotta worry about the push-offs. It comes out quick. You know, this is a frame one or two move. It's quite good. In fact, we saw this matchup. Was it at Shine? Was Wizrobe was in the finals, right? Against Alvin, and Alvin did this. He kept spamming this. I don't know about spamming, but he would sort of do a get up from edge to a roll, and then just get that down B off as soon as he could. Wizrobe is having a hard time dealing with that.
Yeah, and you don't really have the option of parrying that move since it's a multi-hit move.
Yeah, right. Once
like
again,
the
these.
Drill.
Once again, the drills are gold. So it looks like with his style of play, Doug Masters is really smart to stay out this top platform and try to control it like he's been doing recently. But Leo has just taken it away from him and then seeded it back. See if this fireball edge guard will pay off soon.
Really, really nicely spaced up smash there. I believe Yoshi's whole head is invincible, right, during the up smash.
He does have good invincibility on his up smash, as does Mario. We've seen a few times this set Mario up smash beating the Yoshi down B, and that's because of those.
Yeah, it can certainly be hard approaching a grounded Mario or Yoshi. hard.
So if Leo Garcia can bait out a couple of these down Bs and get a good punish, he might be in a decent position to close out this match. But that is not a good sign. And he jumps to his death. So we're going to a game three, boys. Who are you liking in this matchup so far? Who do you think is going to take it?
What is it, 1-1?
It's 1-1.
I think if Mario can make an adjustment here, maybe bait those down Bs out so we can get a good punish, then he can certainly take it.
Well, let's get our pretty faces a little better in here. Huh? Yeah, that's right. I mean, if Leo Garcia can get some success and he does a character switch, what do we think about this? Felt like the Mario wasn't working for him.
Samus does have her own parry of sorts through the up B.
Right.
And that does work on multi-hit moves too, right? Because it has the hitboxes that come out right away as well.
Yeah, that's right. It is, for a multi-hit move, it's maybe stronger, you know, than Yoshi's because of the fact that you don't have to worry about it as long as you get good timing on the first one. So that's something to consider. I do wonder what happens if we get a down B from Yoshi into an up B from Samus. Obviously, that's going to be really dependent on the timing that the up B comes out.
Yeah, I think it will definitely be harder to avoid Yoshi's down Bs with a character like Samus as opposed to Mario. Mario's a little faster in the air and can make adjustments a lot quicker.
That's right, and that missed tech is going to cost Leo his first stock of the deciding game. Well, you don't need good timing if you have spawn invincibility. That'll parry everything. And unfortunately for Samus, he's going to lose his charge shot if he gets hit while he's charging it. So he's back to level zero.
That's a pretty good bait there.
Oh, and he just swag edgeguards him. He knows he can't make it. So here's a fun fact for you guys. Samus' neutral B has 7 different levels. I believe it's at increments of 3% each.
I did not know that. Alright, misses the charge shot. Gets punished for it.
Ooh, and that is not going to be good. Samus does not have any jumps, but it looks like she will be given the chance to recover there. Say she, though. Obviously, Leo Garcia is piloting this character. And that up smash is going to do it.
Yoshi can be hard to edgeguard sometimes with that super armor, allowing him to keep jumping through the hits. But the higher percentage Yoshi has on him, the easier it is to break those super armor.
Yeah, that's right. It seems sometimes like you can just get a free hit on a Yoshi because, you know, if they use an aerial, they're going to lose that super armor, right? But, of course, the good players will wait for you to hit them and then immediately counterattack you. And that's what makes edgeguarding Yoshi very scary. Be very careful how you space your attacks. And that side smash is going to be well spaced. Dash dance, dash attack.
Not quite gonna kill.
So one thing that Yoshi's gonna have to worry about is that even special moves can get stale. And so it can go down to a maximum of 75% damage total. So you're losing 25% of the damage and corresponding knockback most of the time.
Waiting for that charge shot to come out. There it is.
Ah, there we go. Once again, he's going to opt for the shield grab and the no-look edge guard. That's how you know you have game knowledge right there. Ooh. Bugmasters ignores my advice and goes for the forward smash, and it pays off great for him. So. Oh, would you have done the runoff forward air there? Would you have gone for it?
I would have gone for it.
That's pretty scary.
Yoshi's at low percentage, so even if Samus could get that up B off in time to get escape it, he'd still be able to recover.
That's right. And wow, he gets him with the double jump counter down B. That is far from the first time we've seen that this set. That is pretty impressive. Of course, going for a double jump down B like that is very scary because you immediately lose your armor. And if a stray aerial hits you off stage, wow, look at that.
I think even without the double jump first, you lose your second jump, right?
Oh, is that the case? Yeah. And they're trading jabs, and the forward smash comes out. Misses the read, though. And we have quite a game. Just a reminder, this is game three. So whoever takes this last stock is gonna win. And he gets him with the roll. A little extra damage. And we are in armor break range. 93% a strong Samus back air or down air is going to break that Yoshi armor.
Down to the wire here, last stock, last game. Both characters at getting pretty high percentage.
And it is just so even right now.
Oh,
that's not going to do it, but I think one more will. Goes for the up air.
That would have done it.
And did he bait it out? He did. Is that forward throw going to do it, though? Back throw certainly would have. And he is going to get the swag edge guard. So Leo Garcia brings it back. Shows his ability to adapt. Impressive stuff. Congratulations to him. And of course, this is pools. So I don't think it is the case that Doug Masters is out yet, right? I think we're doing double elimination pools into a top eight.
Right.
So we do have, as you said, quite a few contestants here. We've got quite a crowd here at the Oregon Convention Center, Portland Convention Center, I guess I should say.
All right, next up, I think we got Daniel, P039.
Okay, he's P0 is an Olympia player.
Yeah, he has a retro gaming store up there where he occasionally hosts tournaments for 64 and Melee.
That's excellent. I love to hear about tournament organizers.
Yeah, I've gone up there a couple times myself.
Nice.
I think he's starting to pick up steam around with the locals around there, getting some locals into the game.
Well, that's great. And of course, that's exactly what we're trying to do here in Portland. Through our hosts here, Epic Gaming. Big shout out to them. This is a retro gaming convention where lots of people who don't play Smash are going to be around, and they knew that was going to happen, so they brought a bunch of different controllers that they are just allowing people to use from them for free for their tournament matches, and because of them, we have a huge tournament here, which is great.
I guess we don't have Daniel. Keith, Kit, Aloro, and Apathy.
All right. Do we know anything about these players, I wonder?
Never heard of them. Apathy is the Fox player here, and Keith being the Mario player.
Okay. Oh, so we warmed up against Apathy, actually. You and I did. He was the player who was looking for a controller.
Oh, yeah.
I was pretty impressed with him. He was doing short hop Z-canceled aerials and things like that, but I don't know anything about Keith and Kit Aloro, I guess we should say, so... So we'll have to see how this goes. Quite a nice combo from Apathy. That's really nice. And I do wonder if he could have just stayed on edge for a little bit longer, done that normal getup. But here an edge guard will do it, and he knows that. Very impressive stuff so far. Let's see what Kit Aloro can do. Do you play this matchup a lot?
No, actually, I don't. Played it a couple times, but not enough to really know too much about it.
So I went through a bit of a Mario phase, and I just find this matchup pretty hellish. it just feels like, I mean, I think it's a nice matchup because it's sort of like Mario and Fox have sort of similar movesets. Mario's just significantly slower, but of course his recovery is much better. So what you really have is Fox, who often has stage dominance in the neutral of all of his matchups, but it's very easy to gimp, especially for somebody with such a good recovery. So what Mario's aiming for here is just to get a grab and throw him off stage, try to get that edge guard in at low percents. And Fox is really looking to go for a big combo or just chipping away, right? Looks like so far he's done both of those quite well. And he gets pineappled with that up B. That's too bad. Of course, Mario's up B doesn't send him totally upwards. Gives him a little bit of an angle, so it's not uncommon, unfortunately, to get bonk your head on that stage.
Yeah, Fox here is just not giving Mario a rest here.
But that he gets a little greedy off stage, and that gets turned around on him. So Kitaloro showing that can't just be totally disrespected here. Here comes that Hydra down smash. Dodges the edge guard. This could be a turnaround. But I think he didn't anticipate that Apathy would land on that side platform.
Yeah, Apathy is doing a really good job of just spacing things out, waiting for Mario to approach and then hit him with the back air.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I gotta say though, he's looking a little bit greedy on these edge guards. And if Kitaloro can continue to dodge those forward airs off stage from Fox, he is in a very advantageous situation for that reverse edge guard.
I feel like oftentimes Fox players are no, maybe they're impatient or something, but I see many Foxes playing in a very similar style where they're just going in and throwing out hitboxes.
Right.
Fox is a very fast character and can get away with dancing around like that.
That's right. I think, I mean, in general, he tends to attract the sort of APM, the actions per minute players, right, who are just spamming out tech as much as they can. But lately, we have seen a couple Foxes on big stages who have a much more patient, sort of measured style, right? So LD comes to mind as a great example of a Fox who has these great combos that come up. Looks like my match might be coming up next. But I think that, especially if you look at how the Fox versus Pikachu matchup has developed over the years, a lot of it is just at low percents, instead of going for huge combos, going for sort of, you know, grab to tech chases, try to get Pikachu off stage. And even though it's hard to edge guard Pikachu, it's not hard to chip away at him as he's using his up B, right? Though Apathy is showing us that a high action per minute Fox can look pretty good. So maybe he doesn't have to worry about slowing it down at all.
Again, we see that greed there. He's able to get the dash attack. Mario still can recover from this.
Oh, and he trades somehow. Was that a neutral air, do you think?
I don't know. It looked like a forward air first. Maybe the second air over there was a neutral air. Yeah, I'm surprised that traded.
Ooh, so we're going to see the all-black Captain Falcon coming out from Apathy. You know, I mean, historically, this is a bad matchup for Falcon for a number of reasons, right? It is pretty hard to combo Mario compared to other characters, and it is very easy to get gimped by Mario. Well, let's see what Apathy has for us.
Mario has quite a bit of frame one move that'll allow him to escape out of fake combos.
That's right, if you're just a little bit slow, you can really get punished with a lot of things. So the up air comes out before frame three, right? The down B and the up B both come out before frame three. Is there anything else that people like to use out of?
Are they frame one?
I believe that the up air might be. I think that the up B is two or three frames, and the down B, I believe, is frame one, but shouldn't be quoting frame data without actually knowing what I'm talking about. And then we see that up B just totally demolishing Falcon's down air.
Gets the combo down air into up air.
I actually think that's one of the coolest Falcon combos because it kind of shows that you know that up air is going to kill, right?
Yeah, right.
Because a lot of times when your opponent's at high percent, the thing you're trying to figure out is how do I get a back air or a down air, you know? You're not looking at an up air anymore because it really is going to go top screen.
We're seeing some pretty good edge guarding from Mario there. He just wasn't able to finish it off.
Oh, and I think Kid Alora did not realize that he had lost his second jump to that down air. Just gets America. Let's see what we got here. Okay.
Gets a grab.
So that is definitely a hard situation to get a combo on against Mario or against any character when you're, you know, just pixels from the edge like that.
Yeah, no space to run.
So that forward air up air up B is the combo you want to be going for. Though generally, once you hit Mario with one aerial attack, you need to stick hop that forward air so that your up B will reach. Otherwise, as you say, the down air, the down B and the up B will get you out of that as Mario.
May have been better off just back throwing there. May have even killed.
Yeah.
That's pretty high percentage.
So Apathy did not bring his own controller. He's using a borrowed controller from Epic Gaming, but that doesn't seem to be slowing him down. He's looking pretty clean with all of his tech. Fastfall Z canceled aerials. Consistently doing the ledge hop aerials to attack Mario.
All right, a lot of whiffs going around. Falcon didn't get the grab.
Oh, and he goes for a very greedy edge guard, and he's gonna get punished for it. That's it. As soon as you let go of the stage like that, a lot of people will immediately jump, and that dash attack looks like it stole it. But unfortunately, Kid Alora didn't realize his jump was gone. So Apathy's gonna take that in two games, quite convincingly, I'd say. We should definitely talk to him and figure out where he's from.
Is that Apathy?
That's right.
I've seen him at Epic Gaming a couple times.
Oh, have you?
Yeah, I think his main game is Melee. But he's joined the 64 tournament there.
Hey, guys. I can fill the information. Apathy's a major Melee and PM player, but he often will screw around with 64 as well. So he plays Fox in all three games. He agreed to come to the tournament this weekend specifically because, quote, I don't have to try to play multiple games in the same day and make them all bad.
Oh, yeah, sure.
So that's what he's doing. He's choosing to play 64 today. And then tomorrow he's going to play Melee, and Sunday he'll play PM. Fox all the way. There you go.
Great, excellent. Right. That's great. Thanks for the information.
You bet.
Yeah, well, that's good to know. And I got to say, it doesn't surprise me that he comes from other Smash games, given that, you know, he's not a player that we know much about, and yet he was looking really clean there. Especially from Melee, a lot of the tech skill is going to translate back and forth. You know, you got the short hop and the L cancel or Z cancel, things like that. Though, of course, he, fortunately for Apathy, he gets to use a real controller while he's playing this game, so that must be nice for him. You know, he doesn't have to use that GameCube shit.
Yeah, I don't know. The GameCube controller just doesn't feel right in my hands.
Yeah, of course, we're joking a little bit. The GameCube players are notoriously fond of that controller that Nintendo gave us decades ago.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome us again to the Portland Retro Gaming Expo.
I really like the three palm 64.
It makes sense because then you can use all of your hands.
My name is DJ Switch, y'all. I'm going to be your DJ.
All right, so let's take a look at what we got here. Christian Yuen is against Nizondo. Okay, and we have Nizondo playing Fox. Christian Yuen playing his Falcon. This is just a classic matchup, I've got to say.
Right here at the Retro Gaming Expo. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and make a little noise for DJ Rockin'. Give it up.
I'm sure that you have experience on both sides of this matchup. I know that you like to play Fox every now and then, and Falcon is one of your mains. So what do you think about this from both sides?
I think this game heavily depends on who's got the better baits a lot of the time. Both characters are super fast. and you can punish each other really hard. Pretty volatile matchup.
Right.
A lot of times, I feel you just gotta bait your opponent into doing something that they've always done and taking advantage of that.
Yeah, so it is interesting that you bring that up. A lot of spacing, especially in 64, you can get by with really good reactions and sort of having a plan on what you're going to do if they approach you. But with two characters that are this fast, it is often very hard to react in time to what's going on. So as you say, a great strategy is to just try to bait your opponent into doing something that you can predict, and then you can punish them.
Nice forward smash to finish off the first stop.
And he gets the read up smash. That is quite impressive by Nizondo. So in general in this matchup, you have two sort of like glass cannon-y kind of characters, right? You have Fox, who has the advantage in almost every neutral matchup, but is very easy to gank because of his poor recovery. And then you have Falcon, who has the strongest zero-to-death combos in the game, but once again, he doesn't have a good recovery. So it's really interesting seeing the two play styles. You got Falcon with his combos and Fox with things like single low lasers and grabs to try to gimp Falcon.
Nice forward smash for an Asgard.
And that's two forward smashes, two kills, so. I haven't seen a lot of lasers out of Nizondo here. But he has been doing a decent job tech chasing, I think. His first kill was a tech chase up smash, and we saw him get a few things there as well.
Yeah, Nizondo seems to be the more reactionary player here, waiting to see what Falcon does before he throws out his attack.
That was nice spacing on that Fox recovery to just be far enough away that Falcon's forward smash is not going to hit. Nothing wrong with that. Now, of course, dash attack when your opponent is low percent or has a chance to shield it is very dangerous because the ending frames on dash attacks will almost always lead to a shield grab. Or at low percents, even if you hit them, they will be out of hit stun before you're out of ending frames. And once again, we see a great tech chase read with that up smash.
Ladies and gentlemen, if I can have your attention, please, just briefly, if you see a phone with a blue and yellow case, please take it to the lost and found up front by the registration desk.
So it looks like these players are both pretty content to play a grounded neutral game. And I've got to say, I think in that situation, Fox lasers are just invaluable.
By the registration desk. Thank you.
It can really shut out a lot of Falcon's approaches. Best approach in the game we just saw right there with the dash grab. Got a nice string of aerials there from Nizondo. Oh no, and that is going to be an SD.
Yep. This grabs.
Well, I got to say that with that up tilt connecting, this is an even game. We're at game one here, just a reminder, you can see in the top part of the screen, the game count 0-0. And we're doing best of three double elimination pools. Into top 8 later. Oh, he just misses that standard combo. Just fires off his uppie a tiny bit later. And he has some nice short hop aerials out of Nizondo, I've got to say, but that read is going to take the first game. What do you think of all these forward smashes? They obviously paid off.
Yeah, they certainly are. I mean, what was that, like four stocks or some forward smashes? One from up tilt.
Okay, and so it looks like we're getting a heavy counterpick here. Of course, because Christian Yuen won the first game, he has to select his character first, and Nizondo is happy to counterpick him with Kirby, which I think is pretty widely agreed to be Falcon's worst matchup. Do you have thoughts on that?
It is a very hard matchup. Kirby can be quite brutal against Falcon. Even thrown off the stage at 0%, it's really easy for Kirby to edge guard Falcon.
the registration desk.
Right, yeah, I mean, Kirby's grabs in general are not very good mid stocks. They're really great at finishing off stocks, but you brought up an interesting point that Kirby's back throw especially is a very good way to set up a gimp against Falcon, right? So it'll throw you a little bit diagonally, but most importantly, it turns you around, which means you cannot grab the edge with your second jump. You have to use your up B. And of course, even though Falcon can use his neutral B to turn around, just like everyone else, you do not want to be using Falcon Punch at that low percent, that close to stage, because you probably will not make it back. There we see a patented edge guard. So I haven't seen any up tilts from Nizondo yet. I wonder if that's something that he's going to bring out a little bit. He has been spamming this up air, though. Seems to like that aerial.
Yeah, up tilt can be a hard thing to work around if Kirby stays grounded and times those up tilts perfectly. Or even just a Kirby spamming up tilts can be hard to get around.
Yeah, I mean, there's... Put it this way, there has been a lot of effort in trying to learn how to dash grab between Kirby up tilts, just because of how strong it is. If you don't have that, you know, that game knowledge down, a Kirby who spams up tilts against you is very hard to beat, despite the fact that it's incredibly predictable. So we have a Falcon research group on Facebook. You know, there's a sort of a development group, right, for each of the characters. Yeah. And the Falcon one recently, somebody posted a sort of a triggered macro that just spams a button over and over. And they set it up for Kirby just to spam up tilt so they could practice getting in and getting that dash grab in.
Oh, very nice.
And that just shows you, you know, how annoying that move can be. Looks like Nizondo is not favoring it though in this set so far.
It doesn't look like Nizondo has quite the mobility with Kirby that he did with Fox, so he's not able to dodge around a lot of Falcon's moves like he was with Fox.
That's right. You wonder if Nizondo might be a melee player as well, because I believe Kirby is very bad in that game, so a lot of people might not be using him. Though if he has any experience with Jigglypuff, I gotta say it's not that different, right? I mean,
with an up air. Kirby's up air is not particularly good.
Yeah, so this is one of the fixed knockback moves in the game. Right? So no matter what percent Falcon is at, the up air will always send you the same distance away.
Alright, great forward air to protect from a Falcon down air.
Look at that edge guard too, that's great stuff.
Yeah, he was able to turn that around into that forward air.
And I've got to say, he's turned this whole game around. He definitely knows about the up tilt. I saw him do that last stock. So if he can pull out a surprise up tilt combo here on this last stock, that'll be great for him to send it to game three. And as you mentioned, you can see that up air is going to lose to almost every other aerial. Even Falcon's down air is going to beat it.
I'm not a Kirby player by any means, but when I have played Kirby, the one thing I do the most is pivot up tilt.
Oh no, and that is just brutal.
That is sad.
Nizondo accidentally fastball SVs. The last stock of his winner side of the pool, I guess we could say.
So up tilts alone can be pretty predictable, but if you throw in a pivot beforehand, that can make a great way of sneaking in under your opponent and getting a quick up tilt.
That's right, though. I've got to say, pivot up tilt is not the easiest tech in the world, right? This isn't something that you can expect people who haven't spent some time in training mode to be nailing, right?
Yeah, that's true. It does take a little while to get it down. But it's quite useful once you do have it down.
So what was your journey to learn how to pivot up tilt consistently? You have a training schedule, or you just threw it out until you got it?
I actually first learned with Kirby because I watched some match where, I think it was a Revan match. Yep. No, actually it was Kuro Propi. 2015 SmashCon playing Blue Kirby.
Yep.
And that was his main way of approaching a lot of the matches I watched him play. So I started practicing with Kirby, just first get your pivots down, then learning to up tilt right after it without jumping, of course, or up smashing.
Jasper. So when you're going for a pivot in general, it's pretty easy just to sort of flick the thumbstick back and forth and let it return to neutral by itself by letting go with it, right? And then that'll get you a pivot if you just let your thumb slip off the thumbstick at the end.
Oh, really?
But of course, that's not what you want to do for pivot up tilt, right?
No, because
now you have to snap into an up tilt position.
Yeah, I don't think my controller would actually allow it. I don't think it springs back fast enough or hard enough.
Okay, well, that's probably good for you.
Yeah.
So it looks like we got a hand warmer here because I don't believe 99 stock is how this game is going to go. So we'll let these guys warm up for a little bit. So you mentioned Kiro Kuropi's Kirby, and of course he is. He was quite well known as trying to switch from Pikachu to Kirby for a while, and it's a great success, I would say. Did a great job against the Falcon matchup.
All right, Daniel Llamas is the Jigglypuff player here. That's Tyler Thompson playing Kirby. Tyler Thompson, but that is not him.
So, of course, Daniel Llamas is the player you were talking about before.
Yes, he's the owner of a retro gaming store in Olympia.
Okay, and what's his tag normally?
T039, I believe.
T0, right. And he's gonna start it off with a quick little sequence there. That up tilt to rest is very strong in this matchup. And he was close to getting another one, but... Maybe a little bit of DI there in front, save Kirby. Expect to see that down smash is going to drop into more grid.
Yeah, Jigglypuff's down smash is pretty great. It hangs out there for a while. It's got a huge hitbox below the stage.
So it looks like Daniel is doing a great job controlling the space. If he's not on the top platform, it looks like he's controlling the middle pretty well.
Looks like that was almost gonna kill.
Oh, and wow, he goes for the rest. An up air would have done it. But you gotta get in your opponent's head, huh? So Jigglypuff's down air is a very interesting aerial, right? So it has a special property that if you don't Z cancel it, you get an extra hitbox to come out.
Ah, yeah.
And this is true of a few other moves. Pikachu's forward air and Kirby's neutral air, things like that. These have extra hitboxes that come out if you decide not to Z cancel. But Jigglypuff's down air is really the only one that will be consistently used because it'll pop your opponent right up in the air just like you saw there, and you still have enough time to go for that up tilt rest. So very convincing stuff from Daniel Llamas. Obviously he knows what he's doing.
Definitely a 5-star. Very quick game.
And it looks like he's going to switch to Falcon. And Tyler's going to opt into Pikachu, which I got to say is not a great matchup for Pikachu if the Falcon has his combos down.
All right, starting off stylish. And with zero the death.
There we go. That's going to get in your opponent's mind.
Yeah, that is a standard Falcon right there. Up airs and up B.
So what kind of controller does P-Zero use? Do you know?
No, I don't.
I'm trying to look over there, but
I think it's just a normal OG 64 controller.
Whenever I see somebody using taunt cancels, I do wonder if they're using that Hori pad, right? Which will give you access to L without moving your other hand. But it looks like P-Zero is not using one of those. It just has a standard controller. And in fact, now that I think about it, I asked about his controller earlier, and it is in fact just a normal controller. Normal original. And he is just... He is looking great in this match so far. You know, Pikachu is considered the best character in this game. Very few people would dispute that. But Falcon on Dreamland is one of the matchups that, even since 2014, people have called this a 50-50. And lately, I think a lot of people will agree this is better than 50-50. It's more in Falcon's favor. Pikachu is just the perfect weight to get good edge guards. Good combos on. As Daniel Llamas goes for a nice edge guard, but
yeah, this is definitely another game of combo game versus gimmick game.
And
combo game wins again with a 5-star.
Yeah, he gets 2 5-stars in a row. In tennis, we call that the double donut. Little fun facts for you there. And so that's pretty impressive from P-Zero, but I think that just shows that somebody who, you know, spends the time to get good at this game, the skill gap between them and a player who maybe doesn't play as much, I don't know much about Tyler Thompson, but he might be one of the more casual players here, just playing for fun. There's an incredible skill gap if you spend a little bit of time learning this game, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I remember when I first learned about Z-canceling. I didn't know anything about Z-canceling, and I learned that one simple tech, and it just put me miles ahead of all my casual friends.
That's right, yeah. It can catapult you ahead pretty quickly. Of course, there's a lot of advanced tech in this game, and all of it is very useful in different situations.
Yeah, really, Z-canceling is just kind of the start.
Oh, no. And so we're getting into this game here. Looks like Leo Garcia is playing his second game already against Eli Duncan. And unfortunately for Eli, he self-destructed first. Oh, no, and he does it again. Two self-destructs in a row. This is not what we want to see.
I think Leo is just playing some strong mind games here. Or no, Eli.
Yeah, so he does get a nice pivot forward smash. A lot of people consider pivot the best movement option in the game. It's sort of just the wave dash of melee. Because it's much easier to perform a pivot in this game than in the other one, so it's really a reliable movement option.
Blasted of that down B connecting. Perfect.
So I just want to point out that Leo Garcia is in fact a player that we saw a few matches ago who played Mario and then Samus. And so now we're seeing his Luigi come out as his third character. Eli Duncan, this is his first game that we've seen so far, at least on stream. And we can see that despite the two times killing himself, he's brought this back to an even game. So props to him for that.
Like I said, he was just playing mind games with certain stuff.
Yeah.
Making it seem like he didn't know what he was doing. Throwing his opponent off.
This is the 2017 Oregon meta, guys. Neutral is all that matters. Getting in your opponent's head, that's the way to win neutral. So, of course, Kirby has quite a strong recovery just with his six jumps that he has. That'll get him almost all the way back to stage. Every time. And unfortunately, Leo's just being a gentleman here. Leo decides that my opponent has suicided twice. I should at least do it once to make this a fair game. And now I expect him to turn it on and really get back into this. All right, misses Z cancel. That could have been a nice down air into up B for the kill. So it's worth mentioning that Kirby is currently second on the tier list, and Luigi is last. 12th best character in the game by a lot of people's standards. Of course, it's important to remember that these tier lists are designed for high-level play, right?
Yeah, I would say a low-level play tier list, or even a casual tier list, would look a whole lot different.
Absolutely.
Maybe with Kirby being the top, actually.
Maybe. I think you had a graph where you had sort of player skill and, versus how good a character is. I think Kirby would stay up there at the top pretty much the whole time, right? Even with casuals, he's very strong, and at a high level, he's considered second best in the game. So, but if you run into Falcon Punches, that is not going to go well for you. It looks like Leo is happy to give him the space to recover. Maybe he's too scared about getting counter-edgeguarded. But it looks like he is the one who's going to counter edgeguard him with those SD mind games. Oh, this could be the start of something nice, but he misses his Z-cancel on that forward air. Could have definitely led into something cute off stage.
All right, that's all back air by Falcon. Goes for a rogue Falcon punch. Doesn't end up...
Oh, and he gets that hook. That is just going to be savage. So it must be said that Eli Duncan came back from this exact same deficit last game. Right? He had killed himself twice and then brought it back and eventually won.
Some rapid jabs from Falcon, it works out.
So I think a big thing that will take your game to the next level, and I think a big thing that a lot of people who play against computers a lot don't really get, is your options, your defensive options out of shield. Right, this is not something that you really have to learn against a computer, because computers don't have great shield pressure, right? They have inhuman reactions, but their move select and their choices on how they're going to attack you in shield is not ideal. So I think a lot of people don't have good experience, unless they've played this game with real people a lot, what their defensive options are.
Up tilt, or up air. There's a nice rising neutral layer through that top platform.
I've been impressed with Eli's choice of moves that he's been using. Maybe his control is a little bit off. I'm not sure if he's using a loner controller that he's not used to. It seems like he doesn't have quite the control of his character that he would like, but he has been doing some nice stuff. And there he reads the Falcon run and gets him with a down smash, which is great. So we've got an even game here. And unfortunately, that is not going to combo. Here we see a couple of those up tilts. I must say I would have liked to have seen a couple more, but it's definitely nice to see. So we saw the forward air, or the forward tilt there from Kirby. That's a bit of a rare move, but it is something that we've seen lately. Fukuro, who's a lot of people consider the best Japanese Kirby, and perhaps the best Kirby in the world because of that. Actually, he likes to use it in certain situations on shield. So a fun fact is that every single one of Kirby's tilts comes out on frame 4, including his forward tilt. So you're definitely not losing any speed by using that attack. Yeah. Get a little bit of advice from our Epic Gaming hosts.
I think he just came over to tell us to watch this.
Welcome once again to the Retro Gaming Expo 2017.
That's the point of that one.
Right now, I have just a brief announcement.
Oh wow, and that could have been it right there. We were in an edge guard situation. Kirby has a huge advantage against Captain Falcon, but he just sneaks by and gets that Dark Hog.
I think that's going to be it.
Here's that forward tilt, and that down air is going to close it out. So we see a 2-0 from Eli Duncan despite the SDs, so that's quite impressive mentally.
Yeah, he was pretty good at getting out there with Kirby to get those down airs, those easy edge guards on Falcon.
And perhaps he just needed a little bit of warm-up. We saw him going off stage and accidentally fast-falling. Maybe what he was going for is a rising down air and just pressed his aerial key a little too early. So I think that is, it bodes well if he's going to get warmed up. He's going to be ready for his next matches. Maybe without any SDs to get in his opponent's head, huh?
It is really quite loud in here.
They've got some music bumping.
Where is that music?
I don't know if you guys can hear any of that, but it's got some good retro stuff going on. So it looks like Apathy is going to be back on stream with his Fox against Spats, who we have not seen yet. I'm not sure if this is his first game in pools, or if he's won his first game or lost. But we once again get this classic Falcon-Fox matchup. See what Spats can do here off this grab. He gets him with the Super Broom Fan. But we got a nice looking combo, right? And Apathy is really going to punish him for missing that tech on the ground. Gets him with another forward air. I think what Apathy was going for there is a couple back airs off stage. Even if the first one is weak, here we'll see it right now. That's a great option. I think going for that second one obviously didn't pay off, but those weak back airs, it's very hard for Falcon to get around them. They just have such good hitboxes. They're what we call a sex kick, right? The hitbox just stays out forever. Not forever, obviously.
Well, it gets weaker as the longer it's out, right?
It does get weaker, yeah.
That's the whole point of the sex kick.
That's right. That's funny, yeah. Of course. We've got some top tier innuendos. And that short hop neutral air is going to push Fox off stage. We'll see if Spaz just misses this edge guard. He's looking pretty hungry for a forward smash to finish off this stock.
Yeah, I've seen him get a couple of pivot forward smashes, which can be pretty good if you have your opponent coming from above. Sometimes catch him as they land with the forward smash.
Oh, and he goes just a little bit too low for that up B. That's unfortunate. And as you can see, it's really not Fox's goal to just shut off Falcon's recovery in one sort of fell swoop. He's really happy to just leave hitboxes out and wall Falcon out. It's okay if Falcon has to use his up B a couple times, you know. As long as eventually Fox gets the stock, that's all he cares about. I do think a problem a lot of players who are getting better at the game have is that they try to go for really strong attacks when weak ones would be better. Obviously, you'd like to land a strong attack whenever possible, but a weak one is gonna come out a lot faster, and it's going to be done a lot faster as well to give you options in case you miss it.
And oftentimes, it's the weak attacks that allow you to continue combos.
Absolutely.
Fox looking pretty crispy here.
He is. I'm liking Apathy's movement a lot. In case you guys missed it, Apathy is a Melee and Project M player who likes to play Fox in all of his games. And fortunately for him, at the Retro Game Con, the tournaments are spaced out each with a different day. So he's going to play 64 today, and then on Saturday play another game, and on Sunday play the last. So he doesn't have to worry about getting his tech all screwed up from playing another game. I do say
to read him. Smash. Falcon rolled away instead.
So unfortunately for Spats, it's hard to know, what kind of advice to give him in this matchup. Because really, if Falcon isn't really dialed in on his combos and getting a zero to death off forward throws, then it's hard for him to get much done in the punish game. And there we see that double back air we were talking about earlier. It's so hard for Falcon to deal with, and Apathy shows us why. So you think we see a character change from Spats here? What would you like to see?
Looks like it. I don't know. This is not the easiest choice. I would prefer to stick with Falcon, and I really like Link.
So you're a fake Link main, right?
Yeah.
As much as I try to discourage you, you continue to play this character. So tell us a little bit about him. And
well, he's a wonderful character and a terrible character. He's a lot of fun to play as, except for when you get thrown off and gimped and back thrown to death over and over, which is what typically happens against Link. He does not have a very good recovery at all.
Right, we saw that right there. I mean, admittedly, Link was at 100% when Fox backed for him, but he wasn't anywhere close to recovering, just distance-wise.
Yeah, right. He does have some pretty good hitboxes, some disjointed aerials, which can be really useful, but they are slow, even though they're powerful. I mean, I guess that's what makes them slow.
Right.
You have to have really good spacing. You have to be really patient. Projectile camping is definitely one of Link's best options for approaching the neutral.
That's right, yeah. He's got not only the boomerang, which we just saw there, but he also has the down B to pull out a bomb. And, you can do strong and weak throws with the bomb, throw it at the ground to make it explode. And then we see it can be pretty effective, both in just chipping away and as a combo starter. And that is just unfortunate. He accidentally aerials off stage. Link's down air especially is going to last a long time before you have control of your character again.
Yeah, very long time. I did figure out that you can full hop off the side platform, instantly doing a down A, and still be able to recover back to stage.
Oh, that's very good to know.
That can be useful, but it's super easy to see coming. So it's not really very useful unless you're right at the edge of the stage.
Oh no, and that's going to be another SD to finish off the game. That's just too bad, but unfortunately Link makes one mistake off stage and he has no chance of recovering. So Apathy takes that easily, and I've got to say, he's looking pretty good.
Yeah, that's his second win today on stream.
Both have been very convincing, especially for somebody who, you know, this is his third most played game, right?
Yeah.
Melee and Project M, I think, are taking precedence over 64 for him in general. So it sounds like he also attends the weekly tournament at Epic Gaming down in Gladstone, and doesn't play 64 there, but maybe from now on we can start convincing him to join us, huh?
Yeah, we may just need to bring some extra controllers until he gets one of his own.
I've got plenty I can bring him.
Some encouragement, and maybe getting some other people in at his level that he can practice with.
Absolutely, yeah.
It can be kind of hard practicing with someone who's, you know, repeatedly force-stalking you.
Absolutely, yeah.
It can be hard to learn in that situation, whereas playing with someone on similar levels, then you can... It's a little easier to spot where your shortfalls are, where you can improve.
That's right. So I think you learn different things by playing against people of different skill levels, right? So if you're playing against somebody who's significantly worse than you, you can still get a good practice on your punish game and your combos, right? You can still try new things and try to see what kind of
controller check, by the way.
Okay, so this is not live. They're just doing a little bit of warm up, even though it looks like it's five stock. So making sure everything is good for these two guys. I mean, so a lot of people really enjoy playing people who are better than them, even significantly better, because even if you don't learn much about your own game, you're going to see what they do to you, right? And then you can try to do that to other people.
Right.
So you can still get a lot done, especially if you have the mental fortitude not to get too frustrated. But I think we both agree that finding somebody around your skill level is going to be the fastest and the most fun way to improve.
Yeah. It's nice to have someone who you're coming to last stock with in most games.
That's right. And it's also fun to sort of grow with them, right? Like you can see their improvement, you can see your own improvement, and you guys are pushing each other. That can be a great way to start a community. So.
Yeah, Mookie with John Well was one of my only practice partners for a while, and we both improved quite a bit just playing with each other. After a while, though, it became clear that we were really used to each other's style, and so we were kind of more reacting.
So, by the way, Tom, you're being called to the field of battle. So we're going to get Apathy on cam.
Oh, great. So yep. You guys are going to get to hear from Apathy, see what he thinks about 64, huh?
And join Prism. Thank you so much, Tom.
Is this the game now?
Yes, this is the game. This is the game.
All right. The game is live. Chris Fassel playing as DK. Vermeer playing as Captain Falcon. Almost gets that Falcon punch up.
I don't think I've ever used a headset before. As
hey,
I'm wearing two...
There
How's
you go.
Going? This is some
great job in your games there.
Oh yeah, thank you. I don't really play 64 much, but it's fun. It's fun. I thought about getting back into it, but I just like don't have a 64, my own controller. That could change for money. But I love the game. It's like I actually first started out with it.
Yeah, Tom Bombadil and I were talking about how we'd like to get you and maybe some other like kind of newer players playing at Epic Gaming.
So this scene isn't like three people?
Yeah, right. And then you have like lots of people to help grow the community and grow each other in skill.
Yeah, I think I could probably get good. I mean, I used to go to tournaments for this game like years ago. So.
Alright, lots of forward smashing.
Lots of
Falcon
punching.
Falcon kick.
Lots of specials. Right.
It's working out for him so far. This is almost a five.
Certainly is. Oh. These guys like their B buttons.
Alright, that's it. Five stocks.
We're not using the player cams at all.
No, I remember what happened. I guess he has to reset the screen or something.
Yeah.
The character switched.
So what's the question, gentlemen?
Oh, we're wondering if the player cams are going to be used at all.
Oh, they will be. We'll get to it. Especially during Top Cut, we'll go to the player cams and do it almost exclusively.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
I was just wondering. I was like, oh, they're there.
Sure, absolutely. You guys, though, are wonderful. I mean, gotta keep you on cam for now.
Right. Ooh, all right. Falcon's got stage. Ooh, now Mario.
Mario's
taking his money back, dude.
Yeah.
Forward smash? Oh, wait.
Yeah!
I love that sound Falcon makes in 64 when he forward smash.
Yeah.
He's like stretching, he's like,
Oh, walks right into that Falcon punch. No, he's able to stop the next one with the
Wow.
And another forward smash.
Mario's just getting the feet today. He's just getting the feet and the punches. All of them. Every limb. Is he gonna hit him with up smash? Hit him with his head? What does he even use when he up smashes? Okay, he got it with his the toe.
Alright. Chipping away with these specials.
Nice tech. Did not see that coming. Got him again.
And
yep. He's really good at Falcon punching.
This is gonna be a double five star.
And forward smash. He's trying to take his money back. He wants his money. Oh, didn't get his money back that time.
Mario
stalling. I think he knows the up air up B combo.
Back there. Just needs edge
what is he gonna
here.
Do? He's gonna edge guard him. Ooh, he knew the forward smash was coming at him. I love how they fall in the front in this game. they just tumble down. In the melee, they changed it into like them hitting the screen.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I just love the old animation. I just think it's so funny.
They're beautiful, really. I mean, this game's a work of art. Oh, he gets the
yeah,
other,
he knows it.
Up,
he knows
up.
Up. He's trying to get him off.
Seeing an incoming Falcon.
Oh, there he is.
Falcon smash.
Is that 1-1?
That was a quick 2-0.
That was a quick 2-0. Okay, they're getting up. I thought they were like picking the next stage. It was like, whoa, that would have been quite a turnaround.
Yeah, that was a 10 stock.
I think I actually have the match.
Edward Vermeer.
I think.
Who's the... It's Tom Bob and Gomez.
Okay. And then I play?
Or whatever. We'll find out.
Okay. What is that guy's tech?
I think he's just Daniel Lamas here. But
okay.
P039 is his...
P039?
Yeah,
I like it.
Olympia, Washington. What? Oh. You will in top 8. I think that's the first time I'm playing.
So you're just chilling out for a while because you're like the only one of the seed, right?
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, you won all the. Sorry, well, it's about. You won all the epic tournaments, right?
I didn't win all of them. I won enough of them.
Oh. Who else got you?
Tom Bombadil took one from me.
Is that one of those guys? The guy with the hair, curly hair.
Curly hair guy. So I was gonna ask the question then, Prism, you say this is a big part of the Oregon community. These are two of the best guys, right? Besides yourself?
Yeah, for sure. I would say likely to be Tom and I in grand final.
There you go.
But I don't know, we could have some sleepers here.
A lot of new faces.
You always gotta watch out for hidden bosses. You never know who's just like in town visiting your.
Yeah.
Oh, look, a tournament. You just go and destroy everyone.
Yeah, we almost.
Or you
had,
never know who's just gonna randomly come from Corvallis or any of the other areas.
We almost had a pretty good player from Utah coming down here to play.
Yeah.
Well, I guess he was gonna have a booth here at Portland Retro Gaming Expo.
I think they're doing warm-ups right now.
Yeah,
I think that's
what
this
like.
Is. I was like, that would have been a really unfortunate. They're both this crazy neutral. They're just on the other side of the stage.
Both of them too scared to approach.
Look at this intense neutral that we're having right now. Show, ooh, taunting, look at the taunts. Yeah. Yeah. He's trying to bait him in. He's trying to get him.
Oh, I see. It's Max Bailey.
Ooh, that was good. You got the frame. I like Falcon's taunt in this game the best. All right, game one. So who is who?
Tom Bombadil is playing Falcon.
Okay.
Max Bailey playing Pikachu.
Okay, cool.
See what kind of crazy combos Falcon can get, and if in this type of situation we can get a
that was rude.
Easy gimp from Pikachu. Oh, not quite. Doesn't finish it off.
Gonna wait on that. Gets an air. Looks like get him off stage.
That was a really good.
See, I would have gone up air there, and then like just done the big thingy, you know. But I guess he wanted to just nair him off and maybe go for a down air or something. It's interesting seeing like what other players want to do in this kind of situation with their opponent on a platform.
That was a very nice up tilt there to avoid that. It's an anti-aerial against that down air that Falcon threw out. Looks like Max Bailey was able to take the first stock.
Ooh.
Narrowly misses that up B there.
So lightning bolt out. Does that thing last forever? No, thank God.
Tries to run up in up B, but Pikachu just jumps away.
Mm-hmm. Oop. Oh, I thought he was getting him with the back air, which would have been sufficient anyway, but he got him with the up B just to make sure. That was good. I like that Falcon up B, but I also feel like it's risky, you know? Like, if you miss, you're just potentially dead.
Yeah, it certainly can be. But there are a lot of situations that
that was brutal.
It's a great combo ender, really. Barely short of getting that grab.
Wow. Got him right under that shield. What are we gonna do? Oh, he's gonna hit him with an up air. Wow, this is a good game. Jesus.
Oh no. Falls.
I love
short.
How fast grabs are in this game. You miss and you just go again.
Yeah.
So no matter how big the character is, too. Because like
Samus and Yoshi all have the really slow tether grabs.
Yeah.
Everyone else is pretty quick.
Pretty
grabs.
Quick, yeah. I know, like in Donkey Kong. Sorry, in Melee, Donkey Kong's grab was like 9 frames or something, so it's a little bit slower just because it's bigger. And then like all the other characters are usually like 6 frames. And then Zelda's is like 13 or something. It's stupid, but like it's weird how they're all different even when they're not like tethers in Melee. But in this, like it's only different because it's a tether. Otherwise I think it's just like all the same, right?
Let's see
what is
Max.
He didn't get to wall him out there. What's he gonna do? I thought he was just gonna go straight for down here. This Falcon's pretty fluid. That was also that was really good.
Really good Falcon showing by Tom Bombadil. Showing how to combo a Pikachu.
Yeah.
How to use your speed to just run up and grab Pikachu when he's not expecting it. No character changes.
Just going right back into it. This guy just mains Pikachu. Is that now? Would that be Smash DI there, or did he just hit him wrong with like that forward air, or that? Yeah.
Yeah, I believe that was Smash DI.
That's crazy. I know that Smash DI is like the only DI in this game that is like really hard to get.
Yeah, it pretty much requires just some intense wiggling of the stick in whatever direction you want to be pushed in.
That was brutal. They're just trying to get each other, trying to grab. Oh.
Oh no.
That's unfortunate.
This will not be a
he's got a whole other stock to work with, though, so he should be fine.
Yeah,
that was a good pivot grab.
Maybe
that's what I would call that.
Ooh,
that's
nice
smart. That
yeah.
was really smart.
Pikachu was not able to come down fast enough to get a hit on Falcon. Slowly falls on top of him with that nair. work that.
Ooh. Unfortunate missed grab there. Could have been the stock.
Ooh. Almost gets the spike there.
Jeez.
This should be a... Yeah, that's stuck. Even with the Falcon Punch, Falcon is not able to cover close enough.
I haven't seen this Falcon go for any Falcon Punch.
I think Max is a little feeling the pressure here.
It seems like it.
Start.
Oh, yeah, I think he tried to get another upgrade there, but he just didn't squeeze it in.
Tom Bombadil is just playing around with him now. Trying to get these down air spikes into the stage.
Yeah, trying to just be all over him.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, wait, not quite.
Alright, let's go Pikachu. I'm going to rip Pikachu here. Let's not hit him while he's invincible, though.
Hey,
okay,
all right,
we got this. Got the edge guard.
Pikachu
oh,
does
that's
have
unfortunate.
That incredible recovery.
Here we go.
Oh no!
Just force smash.
Yeah, is onto the stage.
This Pikachu is like putting in some work right now. There we go. That was a crazy grab.
I did not see that grab coming.
Yeah. All right.
It
I think Pikachu can do it.
Pikachu can definitely do this.
Yeah.
Just one back
he just got to play so safe. One bad jump like that. That's it. That was a good set, though.
Pretty good showing from Matt.
I think I have a match against someone now.
Against Daniel?
Yeah.
All right. Well, good luck.
Ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention for just a quick moment.
We need to get some water. We're going to get some water.
In the Halo 2 overall tournament, that starts in 10 minutes. We have about 10 minutes.
I have a game, but they took the stream setting.
The Halo 2 overall tournament starts at the Xbox Battle Arena. The Halo 2 overall tournament begins in 10 minutes. 10 minutes in the Xbox Battle Arena.
We're
going to
get some water.
So what?
We're going to get some water.
Oh, God. You know, I think they're aware that gamers don't drink water, so they just don't have it here. You know?
I'm gonna go find some water.
Actually, I think only Smash players
right
drink
back.
Water. Right now? Oh, after this? Yeah.
Hello.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Pretty good. This is my second tournament.
Second tournament ever, or second
64? No, it's 64, I think. Well, for a long time, at least. I used to, like, go to tournaments where they had it there, and I could just play for fun. I was never, like, bad at it, but I was never really good at it.
Sure, yeah. So actually, I think it'd be interesting to talk to you about a little bit of that stuff. Cause, so you're a Melee player and a PM player, is that right?
Mostly Melee player. I stopped playing PM because, like, I was just kind of burning myself out with multiple events per day. Like,
sure.
Tournaments would have, like, multiple, like, different events, and I was like, I can't do that. Like, I don't have the capacity to do that. I can only focus on one game at a time.
Yeah,
but,
absolutely.
But, like, this weekend, 64 is today, Melee is tomorrow, and then PM is on Sunday. So I intend to play all the games. Plus, like, the admission pass gets you all weekend
yeah.
or whatever. So why not?
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, what am I losing just playing my games that I like? Why not?
And as far as I can tell, you're only gaming.
Yeah.
So I think it'd be interesting to talk to you about, you play Fox in all three games, I guess?
Pretty much.
Okay, yeah,
that's it.
So I know very little about Project M, but
okay.
I know a little bit about Melee, and I think you know, that's the most common.
Yeah, that is the big one.
So.
Yeah.
So you play Fox in 64 and in Melee. How do you feel in 64?
In 64, I started out actually playing 64 before I even delved into Melee, and I was just like screwing around, you know, with with Fox, just jumping around, learning shoulder hops and all that when I first started. And so it's actually, it's not that it's unnatural, it's just that it's like clunky and it's like rusty for me right now. If I got back into it though, like if I actually got a 64 controller again, I could definitely just do it again. Because I do love this game, it's fun.
Sure, so Prism and I were commentating your sets that were on stream.
Yeah.
And one of the first things we noticed was that, you know, the short hop aerials, the Z cancels all looked really crisp.
Yeah.
So is a lot of that just transferring over from Melee for you?
Definitely, yeah. And it's much easier, you have so much bigger of a window of time to get the Z cancels and all that.
That's right,
in
Z cancel is 11 frames in 64. I'm not sure what it is in Melee.
Yeah, it's faster. That's all I know. It's not this game.
I suppose it's not necessarily the Z canceling window which matters, but the amount of time you're in the air before you hit the ground, right?
Yeah.
In Melee, you're just falling so quickly.
Yeah.
And also, a notable difference is that in this game, you cannot fast fall after you've input an air down. Right.
Oh, that's right.
Whereas in Melee you can't, so did that feel awkward to you at all? You're trying like...
Not really, it's still, that timing is still intuitive. I think because I learned to fast fall in this game, that's how I fast fall in Melee, which is funny. So that carried over from years ago into this, and that's why it's still easy. And some of the things about movement, I guess when I'm just like borrowing someone's controller, I'm not used to it, you know.
Sure,
this thing, I've never used it before, so it's new and I'm not used to it, so I'm gonna... Just like any controller, you're gonna get used to it.
Absolutely. You know, so maybe me questioning you about Melee isn't this isn't the right time, because we have a pretty good game, it looks like, going on in front of us. So we have Christian Yuen coming back with that Falcon. I believe that he's lost the game already. Maybe to you? Unfortunately, I don't know these players very well, so I'm sorry.
No, I didn't play either of them.
Okay.
I played a Mario player, and then I played someone else. I don't actually remember. That's not good.
No, I mean, that's sort of how you want to go through a tournament, though, right? I mean, you want to be a little blind to your opponent, just play the matchup. You know,
that's true. Just play the matchup and take each one at a time. So, yeah. But,
Oh, wow.
Well, how many?
Nice edge guard.
That was pretty good. How many, like, consistent tournament players do you think are here? I'm not going to use the word good, but, like, you know, people who regularly attend events. Like, how many people do you think are here for this tournament?
I think the people who we have here who are pretty invested in 64 are probably around 8.
That's pretty cool.
That's not bad.
That's not bad at all. I mean, and then you've got your... I just saw DK Money over there, someone I know from Melee.
Oh, yeah?
I think he's just scoping out the scene for tomorrow. I don't know what he's doing here on Friday, because Melee's not today. But anyway, and then you go to all the people just like coming in and playing one of their favorite old games. So you've got like basically a bunch of randoms and then people who actually go to tournaments. But it's cool to know that Portland has some actual 64 playing. Yeah. I thought this game was just dead, but it's good that it's not.
You know, a couple years ago it was a little bit, but
yeah.
64 has just been steadily growing linearly for a while. These tournaments are getting bigger and bigger, and we're pretty much hitting sort of like venue limits at this point for our major tournaments. Also, recently we have a bunch of tournaments which are 64 only as majors, which is a big step for us.
Yeah, that's cool.
You know, we used to really just be piggybacking on like the Apex, Genesis kind of stuff.
Yeah. Just be kind of like a side event or whatever.
That's
but
right.
It's kind of cool that you know you guys have your own.
Unfortunately, we were treated as sort of a side event a lot of time. You know, limited stream time, not many setups.
Yeah.
Like that. So it's really great that we're getting the resources we need. And a big shout out to all the 64 tournament organizers across the country.
Yeah. And I'd like to see it grow more here. I mean, each community like has their own tournaments now here, and I think that's really cool. I think most people, like, they play either Melee or Smash 4, and then they kind of, like, they start playing all the other games and then see, like, whatever you start with is, like, a gateway into what game you actually like or feels good to you.
That's
and
right.
For me, it's Melee, and like, mostly, but this one's still fun, and I still, like, want to play this game, so. I would definitely invest in going to, like, 64-only tournaments just because they're really fun.
Yeah,
well,
that's great to hear.
But it'd be hard for me to spread myself out between, 64 tournament, a Melee tournament, though. I mean, maybe I could do it, but maybe once I get better at it or something, but right now it's just like, I'm really trying to, I'm like going hard in Melee trying to get better at that game, and I'm still only going to like one tournament a week because like work 6 days a week, so it's hard to work and then play Melee. It's hard to have a life playing Melee.
Yeah.
It's hard.
That's why it is nice when you have a really good organized tournament every week.
Yeah.
I mentioned this earlier, but a big shout out to Epic Games because you were mentioning there's a lot of people here who are sort of take CS4 seriously, but the majority of our entrants in this tournament are just players who like this game, right?
Yeah, they're just people.
And the great thing is that Epic Games came out with a bunch of controllers. They knew people weren't going to bring an N64 controller to this gaming convention.
Yeah, I'm borrowing this one.
That's right. They're just loaning it out to everyone. So I think that's great. A big part of the success of this tournament is going to be because it's so well organized by Epic Games.
Yeah, and then they're going to get their name out there and probably, you know, more events, people coming to their events, whether it be Vault or Epic, but just maybe even in general, too, just getting the name out there. Oh, what's Epic Gaming? Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I mentioned this a couple times. They run a weekly 64 tournament, also in Gladstone, along with, I'm sure you're familiar with the Melee tournaments they run.
Okay.
And so that's at noon every week. A couple of us come out. So
nice.
Anyone in the area should definitely come by. I met some people from who live in the suburbs around Portland, who I'm hoping I can convince them to come out. Some good players. Actually, the guy I was just playing against on stream, definitely a really solid player. Good fundamentals and stuff. And,
yeah.
It sounds like he's not super involved in the community yet.
Yeah.
I'd like to change.
Honestly, I just want to see more people play the game. Like, I think that's just. You'll ultimately get way better too if there's more people.
As we were talking about Melee, we see a good 64 set in front of us. Looks like Christian Yuen is going to be eliminated for the second time by Eli Duncan.
Yeah.
He's been playing a pretty solid blueberry Kirby.
One second, I gotta steal this setup.
What? They're hopping on first, and then you after them.
Oh, okay.
Right, so it looks like Apathy's got a set coming up.
No.
After this one.
I mean, it's like been two times now where I was like, am I going? Oh, okay, I'm not going. But I guess I'm playing after this one. Whatever.
So early on in pools, you know, when you're just playing sort of like a round robin, double elimination kind of a setup,
yeah.
The mental game is not really as important, right? So it doesn't matter if your game gets pushed back and pushed forward. It's not like, I mean, how much mental preparation do you have when you're playing a set, if it's sort of like a low-stakes set?
So, like, I always try to take my sets seriously. Like, I always, like, play safe at least. And, like, you know, that's my time to, like, get my punish game really going and, like, kind of test the waters a little bit. But also still, like, doesn't mean that I should just go in and not think, you know. Like, I shouldn't be mindless, but... But all the same, you should also, like, if someone's not, like, punishing a clear hole in your gameplay, like, that's a clear hole in their gameplay, so you should just capitalize on what they're not punishing. So that's like, a lot of what lower play is that there are just more holes that people can be capitalizing on or, like, getting in, or people can be getting in, and they're just not. It's not even necessarily the difference between punish game. It's mostly just, like, neutral interactions.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I expect for multi-game players like you, a lot of the value, even when you're playing somebody who you think it might be a bit of an easy set against, a lot of the value is just getting comfortable, you know, inside the engine, right? Like getting used to the game, making sure
yeah.
your fingers feel good on the controller, staying close, stuff like that. So it definitely doesn't make sense to take even the games you think you have on your bag too lightly.
Yeah.
So it looks like we've got a good matchup right here. AJ Daniel versus Christian Reeves Young. I don't think we've seen either of these players on stream unless you commentated on them while I was off doing my match.
Yeah, I don't know who any of these people are. I see some tilts and some bounce back.
Alright, so Mr. Young here playing the old DK. We don't have Diddy Kong in this game, we just got Papa. Daniel playing this Captain Falcon. Traditionally, as far as region goes, this particular Falcon costume is normally called the Mexican Falcon because of players like Jaime and people like Alvin and stuff.
Oh, okay.
There you go. So,
that's cool. Yeah, I don't know any. I know a lot of stuff about Melee, but I don't know a lot of, you know, weird, funny nicknames and things for,
sure.
That is 64. And
that's a brutal SD right there.
That is brutal. He just ran off the stage.
That's really too bad. So, I mean, this matchup doesn't have too much to talk about it. It's pretty much like every Falcon punch. So
Seems
in
like
general,
it.
DK, oh, wow, that is a strong Falcon punch there. In
general, DK is not the kind of character who's going to be looking for gimps against most of their cast. But against Falcon, his recovery is just so bad that, you know.
It's so linear, you can just do it. Yeah, you just toss him off and pin him away.
And of course, against 90% of the cast, Falcon's goal is to get that forward throw into a nice combo.
Yeah.
So this really, once again, is just going to be combo versus gimp, which, like I said, is most of Falcon's matchups.
Yeah.
The spacing is going to be hugely important here. It's a nice fastball down air. Bait him with another one. Just a little bit late on that forward smash. But it looks like we have another SD from Dale. That is really savage. Hopefully that doesn't tilt it too much mentally. How do you come back from making big mistakes like that? Maybe it's not an SD, but you miss some tech or something like that and it costs you a stall.
I actually laugh it off. That's what I've done now. I had a set against someone in Melee last Sunday, Mayan Ryan, and one of my matches that I lost against him, the set ended up being 3-2, but that's because I just kept a really good mindset and just focused on what I needed to do. But the first two games were brutal. Like, in one of them, I just fast fell off and died. I was trying to, do a ledge dash or something, and I think I did an aerial, but I didn't mean to. And I, just died. I'm like, well, there goes that game. I think it was a 0% stock, and it was, about to maybe get evened up, and I just killed myself.
A 0% stock is brutal in Melee.
Oh, it's awful. And you just gotta, especially against Puff, but you gotta just, you gotta just laugh, because if you spend that time, being angry about something that already happened, you're not spending enough time thinking about what you need to do now. Even in the next match, even if that match ended and you're salty about it, I have to be thinking about my next match.
That's right. I mean, complaining about what happened or being salty is not going to hurt anyone except for you, right?
Yeah, so it's not going to do anything for you. You need to focus on what's happening, what's in front of you. That's the only thing that's going
to
help you.
And so you're using a little bit of self-deprecating humor maybe to try to get back in the moment.
Yeah, well, maybe. I don't know if it's self-deprecative humor. It's just crap. I jump off and it's just funny to me. I'm like, well, that happened. But I don't think that I'm bad because I did it. Because everyone does it. Something. Nobody is a perfect player. Even if your margins of making mistakes are smaller, nobody's a perfect player. Everyone screws up. And everyone has even just general off days too.
So it looks like Young is going to take that with just a couple, it looks like they're both playing in a nice attrition damage style and just a couple back throws we're going to see it off.
Yeah, that's kind of how it goes.
Those two SDs probably helped, so.
Yeah, we'll see if we can clean it up with this blue fox. I like the blue fox.
Now Fox has one of the highest second jumps in the game while he's in the air, so it's pretty easy to recover with him at low percents, even if you're not really comfortable with that upbeat.
Yeah.
So hopefully we don't see as many SDs from Daniel this game. And of course Young just sticking with the old Donkey Kong.
Yeah.
So I do just want to talk about the tilting we were just talking about before, where you sort of get in your own head after mistakes and stuff.
Yeah.
Especially in a long tournament, when you're playing multiple rounds, this is like a round robin double elimination pool, so there's going to be potentially a lot of games that you're playing.
Yeah.
And then later on, if you make it in the top eight, you might be gifted a win because your opponent got tilted from one of his previous matches, right?
Right.
This is something that you really need to get under control if you want to make it far in a tournament.
That's true. Yeah. Yeah. You got to be you gotta just let it stay behind you and not carry that stress or emotion into the next match.
That's right, especially when you're in a double elimination setting. Even if you lose the match, at that point you still have one sort of life left.
Yeah.
Worrying about why you lost that last match is only gonna help you in terms of fixing your bad habits.
Right. Yeah. It's good to identify the flaws. But it's not good to. That was pretty good. But it's not good to. Dwell on it, yeah, that's the word.
Oh no, and we do have an SD even without Fox, so.
Oh no.
I wonder if Dano could use some of the advice that we're talking about now about not getting in your own head, because it looks like, maybe he's keeping his cool and it's just a little bit of uncomfortability, with his character. But Young is looking like quite commanding in this attrition damage, let them kill themselves style of play. He's got it going on here.
I wonder if people go back and watch themselves play in their player cam to see the difference in their reactions from than compared to back then, I used to get tilted, look at me get mad about this back then, but now that doesn't bother me. And I think that's like another thing that a lot of players can work on. Absolutely, that'll help them a lot. Because not only are they just better at the game, but they're like just like happier playing the game and not like getting mad when they mess up or lose.
Yeah, absolutely, we're trying to have fun here, right?
Yeah, it's kind of the whole point. there's a Melee tournament tomorrow. And then there's a PM tournament on Sunday.
So we got a nice gentleman asking us about the
tournaments here. Not as far as brackets go. I think everything's already along. Yeah.
Now, the Retro Game Con, as you were talking to this guy about the different tournaments you can sign up for, it's really nice. They have a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, they have a big Tetris tournament this weekend, too, and I actually want to enter that tomorrow because I'm a Tetris player.
That's right. Many people watching this might have actually seen the sort of YouTube video from last time. It has a ton of views, and I watched it just for fun. Here we say as Young finishes off the set. Good looking stuff in that.
Oh, now I play. Now I play. Well, hey, it was good commentating with you. I gotta go play this match.
Good luck on your match.
Yeah, thank you.
So it looks like Apathy is going to go play his game right now on stream, and then I'm going to be up next after him. But until then, we've got Frisbee joining us again.
How's All right.
You play some matches off stream?
No, I just walked around, checked some things out.
Right, so tell us why you haven't been playing matches so far at this tournament.
What's that?
Tell us why you haven't been playing matches so far.
Oh, I got a free seed into top 8. Because for the past like couple months, Epic Gaming was giving 1 point to the person who came out on top of each tournament. So I got like 3 or something. I think you got 2, right?
My wedding and honeymoon made me not attend very much, so I think I only have 1.
Only 1. Okay, so you won 1 tournament there, which got you 1 point. I won 3, which got me 3 points.
And then who else has points there?
I don't think anyone else does.
There were 7 tournaments that counted, because I remember there was a few that I won before they were doing this. So for the past 7 weeks, they've been running the weekly that they've always been running, but for the past 7 weeks, you get, as Chris was saying, a point. And the person with the most points got a free buy in the top 8, which is Chris. Congrats for that.
Yeah, so he's just to play pools.
Yeah, he's just hanging
sucks,
out.
Kind of sucks, actually.
You're not going to get any warmth at all. You're just going to come in cold.
Yeah, I know, right?
So top 8 is going to be later on today, and that's when you start playing the matches.
I mean, the cool part about it is it's not just a seated spot in the tournament. I get to get into this whole expo for free.
That's right, yeah, they paid for a whole weekend pass, I think, right? Which is a $35 value or something.
So, I mean, it's cool just to be here. It'd be cool to come down tomorrow when I have more time to, like, look around, check things out.
Yeah, it looks great. So they have a bunch of stuff set up here.
Lots of
games
to play.
Ground Control has brought their whole arcade, which is pretty cool.
Is that who Ground Control provided those?
Yeah, so Ground Control, for those of you who don't know, is a bar in downtown Portland where it's an arcade that there's a bar at. So you go in and you drink and you play arcade games. It's really
barcade.
Fun. The barcade, that's right. And so they've come down here and they've set up their whole arcade for the Retro Game Con. So there's a huge amount of arcade games, pinball, and they have that one that people love these days where you're like a bee and you're like controlling the thing, like Hive or something like that.
Oh, Killer Queen, is that?
Killer, yeah, they have that one, that's a hit. So it looks like we're getting to this game, and we have a quite good match, right? So we have Apathy, who's been looking like a very clean fox, who's the melee player, obviously, that we were just talking to. And then, that is a misrest, which is not going to be good.
All right, just goes for the solid up smash for like 20-something percent.
And this is P0, so I think this maybe is the... it's going to be one of the closest matches we've seen at a higher level.
Right.
I guess actually, my match on stream, I was pretty impressed with my opponent. He seemed like he had really good fundamentals. And maybe he was not as comfortable with his character as he should have been. He was getting a little upset with himself at the inputs he was missing, but overall he was a good player. So.
Oh, you're talking about Max.
Talking about Max.
Max, the Pikachu player, Max Bailey.
Yeah, I was very impressed with him.
I watched that. That was a pretty good showing from both of you. I was surprised that he was keeping up pretty well in that second game.
Yeah, he was definitely looking good. So, and there is the rest that is going to seal off the stock once again, even alongside of the
stage. At least the second one we've seen. We haven't been paying a whole lot of attention to that.
Yeah, we were talking about how good of a game this is without actually watching it. So when Jigglypuff is offstage against Fox, it is pretty annoying to try to recover because that back air and his quick double jump just makes it really hard to safely get it. And that is a monster read from Apathy with that running up smash.
Yeah, I think this can be a pretty brutal matchup for Puff. I mean, playing as Fox, at least, it feels like you just have to dance around a lot and be fast and surprise Puff with, like, a quick double jump aerial, like, top bomb deal thing.
Yeah, that's right. This matchup is historically considered pretty high in favor of Fox. He has some good punish tools, like his up smash will kill very early, and his shine often sets Jigglypuff off stage at a terrible angle for her.
That's true. One shine and Edgehog can kill Puff at 0%.
I do have to mention, though, as P-Zero is showing us, Fox has a punish game against Fox, which is very strong. And we've been seeing the combos into rest, but even a back throw into edge guard can be very strong against Fox too. So I think this is a matchup where even though Fox has the advantage, he has to be very careful about how he plays. If he gets caught with things like this, it can be really bad for him. And that's going to be it. A couple neutral layers to wall Fox out, and P-Zero is going to take the first game. So once again, this is the best of three. We're doing double elimination pools, and neither of these players have lost, so the loser of this game won't be out.
Do you know if there's a way to turn these headphones up at all?
Pick a dial and...
Oh, well. Yeah. There's a soundboard over here, but I don't know what goes to what.
Yeah, we'll wait for our epic gaming guy to come back.
Seeing a few more lasers here from Fox this time around.
Yeah, but these are some strong punishes from Pikachu.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to get grabbed by Puff.
And so I gotta say that I would like to see Apathy DI those down airs a little bit more. Whenever you have a drill attack, the amount of hit lag is gonna be multiplied by the number of moves that come out. Right? So you have a much larger DI window. And in 64, maybe he doesn't know this, but the positional DI is really all we have. A lot of people call it slide DI or something, smash DI. But it's the smash DI for Melee. It's what we have in 64. And it's dynamic. There's no static DI in this game.
That was a funny looking up smash there.
Yeah, he gets him with the butt smash.
Yeah.
And we've got an even game right now, but this is looking bad. If we get this tech chase from Daniel.
Fox just keeps jumping up into that down air.
So I'd like to try to see Apathy control the stage a little bit more and force Puff to be horizontal to him like he is right now. That's going to be the position where I think Fox has the best advantage to smash up. And when you let Puff get above you and you just keep getting hit by that down air, that's going to be terrible. And unfortunately, he gets a little greedy off stage like we were noticing before. And that reverse edge guard is going to cost him. It looks like a missed input there from Apathy. And some really nice tech chasing with those neutral and up airs from P-Zero. I'm liking the control he has over Puff. Apathy almost pays again for that edge guard. Laser four tilts, pretty nice look.
I think he needed a back air there. Instead, he just rose up without any aerial unprotected.
Unfortunately, Jigglypuff's a little bit too floaty and takes too much knockback to get hit by that standard combo. And that edge guard is going to seal it off. So we have Apathy's last stock on the winner's side of these pools, perhaps, if he can have a nice comeback here. That dash attack is very dangerous in the shield. So at 136%, you're willing to hit Jigglypuff with pretty much anything except for a down air, and you're going to be in a very fair position.
do here. Back air does it.
Spacing the short hop back air is going to be great. It's a great hitbox, and we don't have to time it too much. But this might be a trade stock, and he just misses the down B. That would have been a very nice way to end the set. Apathy's probably wishing he had the melee Fox FB right now. Much better than 64 Fox's FB.
Jigglypuff just needs to hang on to the ledge there and let go, allowing Apathy to get back to stage.
Yeah, I really gotta say, I get pretty annoyed when I see people who can just edgehog who try something else and allow their opponent to recover. There's nothing shameful about going for the edgehog. It just means you have good game knowledge. Right?
Yeah, sure. I'm one of the players who goes for something else. So
a little too close to the
I mean it gets me in trouble a lot of time. It's just, there's definitely a way to play to win. A way to play, just to have fun and be wacky and things.
Sure, and that's certainly true, but I think if you're not using a play to win style against your opponent in tournament, I honestly find that a little disrespectful.
Right, yeah.
So it's okay to sort of try interesting punishes every now and then, especially if you think that you maybe have the upper hand, but I'm not saying if you don't edge hog, then you're a bad tournament player.
Yeah, I'm not saying don't do it in tournament by any means. I mean, when it comes to tournament, I know I definitely buckle down with how serious I'm playing. Sure. I think it almost brings out a different style of play that it can be kind of hard for me to practice in friendly just because, I don't think about it.
It looks like Apathy has really brought it back while we've been talking, and that forward throw is not going to do anything. Push off from there is a great option. It's something I've noticed a lot of Puffs have been picking up since, especially people like Wongera coming over from Japan and showing how strong that is. Well, we've got a bit of an even game here, and that is going to do it. A savage missed Z cancel. Apathy is going to go to the loser side of this pool, but I expect that he will probably be fine. And it looks like I have a match.
All right.
Tanner, I need you over here.
Going to get Apathy back on commentary here. Or not. All right, it's just me then. Yeah, go ahead. That'd be great. All right, we're gonna get P0 on commentary. So we have Tom Bombadil. That'll win this other guy. It looks like he's just doing hand warmers.
Hey, welcome to top 8! Woo!
Made top 8. So you made top 8 too, right?
Yep.
I'm still on winner side.
Winner side top 8.
Nice.
I was choking pretty hard at the end of the last game. Got way too confident, but worked out.
Oh, yeah. Well, those rest combos were really nice.
Yeah. That Tom Bombadil. Right.
Edward Vermeer, that's the Falcon player here.
Alright. Falcon's fun. Really combo heavy. But I think Tom's probably gonna do damage here.
Yeah, we'll see how hard Pikachu can give Falcon. Right?
I wish I could make Pikachu, but no. Can't get that all.
There it is. Something like that, and Falcon just cannot get back.
Actually, Tom is taking too long.
Gets grabbed, just running right up to Falcon.
Jab grab.
Catches him with the forward air, but he gets dug hugged. Nice up air, that kills.
Nice, so it's pretty even still. Percentage really doesn't matter in this matchup. It's pretty much all zero to grab here.
Yeah, there's
didn't look like Falcon was going to reach it anyways, but no need to go for anything fancy. We need to just hang on to the edge.
Round three, so winner here goes into top eight, right?
Yeah, I'm not sure actually. I haven't really looked at the bracket.
I know. I signed up for the Halo 2 one, so. Alright, so pretty convincing right now that Tom's taking this one, but we'll see. Comebacks happen all the time. Edward's not out of it yet.
Forwards, man. So Falcon gets back. Ooh, Falcon's able to grab there.
Oh, that was really good.
Not fair. Reverse up there.
And that's game.
Yep, back air. Alright, he decided not to just hang on to the edge.
I always try to do that when I'm playing. Even though I know they're gone, I want to get that last hit. Oh, we got Falcon Dittos here.
Alright. Very combo heavy game, Falcon.
This is probably my favorite matchup to watch, too.
Yeah?
And the play. I actually really love play. I'm too scared to play Falcon in tournament, but. This is probably one of my favorite ones. Just up air, down air.
That is Falcon standard right there. Up air, down. Up beam. Up beam. It was a nice surprise edge guard there, but didn't end up working out.
See if Edward can take that first stock right here. But Tom is just all over him.
And back air.
I thought he was going to try to hug him off.
Yeah. Forward air. Re-grab.
I would like to see a Falcon punch. Oh, he survives. He still can take that first stock, and he takes it. His ability was not out yet.
He's punished back here. That's it. Falcon's up B. Has some startup lag, so you can't get a hit in there.
That range from that floor smash.
Yeah, you don't really see a lot of those in neutral usually, but sometimes it just throws your opponent off and they get hit.
And that's game. Tom Bombadil advances to the top eight. Edward Beener is in the loser's bracket. He still has a chance to make it, but we'll see. Hopefully I don't have to play Tom. He's pretty good. Wrong, man. Good games.
All right, we're figuring out the next match here. It's going to either be Christian and Ricky or Apathy and Nizondo. Seeing what's going on here. It looks like Apathy and Nizondo already playing, and Christian and Ricky are already playing. So actually, we're just waiting for a moment here.
All right.
Unless you have a gentleman sitting down there. It looks like Edward and Desi might be playing here.
All right.
Okay, that's what we're having. Get this up and running. Looks like Desi's on one.
Also, Edward's back.
Yeah, we're gonna see Edward again.
Don't need me to borrow my controller. So Edward, I'm assuming he's gonna be playing Captain Falcon. Yep. I was talking to him earlier today, saying that Falcon probably his favorite play.
Three, two, one.
I believe the winner of this advances to top 8. I'm not so sure.
I'll check the bracket. Looks like they're just going to warm up a little bit.
Game one. Pretty unique Foxy kicks.
Oh.
Yeah, so Desi is the Fox player.
Desi's a Fox player, and Edward is Capcom. Double four smashes.
Oh, that is worked. Unfortunate.
Ladies and gentlemen, just a brief announcement. In about 10 minutes, we're going to start the second round of the Halo 2 Free-for-All.
Oh, I gotta go.
Xbox Battle Arena.
Yeah, well, we gotta go join that Halo 2 tournament.
Right? I signed up for the Halo 2 tournament. Halo 2 is one of my favorite competitive games. Right next to Smash. I love Smash 64. It's fun. Let's see if Mink can hop on here. We can replace.
Alright, we gotta forward throw.
I gotta go. I'm logging off. P0. I gotta go wreck some kids in Halo 2.
Alright, good luck.
Thank you. Hopefully we'll meet in bracket prison.
Yep. Alright. Doc just stands there, allowing Fox to get back. But he's able to finish him off anyways. Gets him with the Falcon kick, and then gets back there.
This looks like a pretty fast game.
Yeah, beat four socks down already. Alright, he's getting him with all these Falcon kicks. There's another one.
Falcon's easiest character in the game. Heard it here first. No, you didn't. You heard it here in 2014, right? No, but I actually don't believe that. A lot of people make a joke that because Falcon's zero to death is the strongest, you just learn him and he's the easy character to use at a high level. And that might be true, but I certainly don't think, you know, he's clearly the easiest character in the game. Like that. What are your thoughts?
I think he maybe has the easiest standard, for sure. I think that's the first one I learned, and I didn't even have to watch videos to figure that one out.
Yeah, so he definitely has really strong combos, but I don't even think that he has the easiest punish game. I think Kirby's punish game is much more powerful. If you land some up tilt, you don't even have to be good. You're up tilt like 20 times, and you should land it, right?
Yeah.
But, of course, every character at a high level takes an immense amount of skill. But sort of at the mid-level, a lot of people complain about Falcon, Pikachu, and Kirby. Incidentally, the top three characters in the tier list. And here you are coming from a privileged position of being a Yoshi main, who a lot of people agree that him and Fox are sort of the most technical characters.
Most what?
The most technical.
Oh.
Using that double jump cancel properly.
Yeah, it can definitely get you into a lot of trouble if you do it at the wrong time and get hit off stage. Or you just don't have another jump.
Okay, so Edward takes the first game pretty convincingly. Yeah, he's the guy who I just played. I thought he had pretty decent instincts.
Yeah, he's gotten a lot of these down Bs and like seemingly random forward smashes that end up connecting.
Yeah, he standarded me once. Standarded. So maybe we have more of that to see.
He gave you the standard. Oh,
he's going for
he's getting pretty
flagging.
Close there, but not quite.
He must really be feeling himself. He's really off the game.
All right,
his opponent is Desi Ayek. I don't know anything about this player. Do you know him?
Nope. Not at all. I like his fro, though.
Yeah, he's looking good. Outclassing me, for sure. So I think he's one of the players who has snuck deep into the losers bracket without playing on stream yet. So he's not somebody we see.
Yeah, right.
Looks like he's pretty happy to stick Fox there, even after that game one loss. And, I saw him do some down tilts at the edge against the low percentage Falcon. That could be, maybe we get some nice gimps going on.
He's missed quite a bit of those forward smashes so far. Not quite as good as Falcon. Gets in there, though.
I think Fox's forward smash is another of those potential worst move in the game things.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. There are certain situations which it can be really useful in. I think it's actually a pretty good edge guard against Link up B because it will put him off the ground so he won't get hit by the blade, but will still hit Link's head.
Yeah, okay, so definitely, and that was very close to a Falcon Punch screen in neutral. When I say worst move in the game, again, I'm joking a little bit as like the good moves, which are probably overused by mid-level players, just like Yoshi's forward smash. Of course, when we're looking at actual worst moves in the game, Jigglypuff's down tilt has got to make the list. It's very hard to even theorycraft a use for that.
Yeah, maybe DK dash attack.
Oh, that clanks with Kirby's up tilt, and you have frame advantage.
Oh, really?
So, get out of here.
There's a bright side.
Yeah. So it looks like Edward is really just commanding this game so far, even with these Falcon punches in neutral. He won last game with a 3-stock, and it looks like he's set up pretty well to do at least that this game.
He's done quite well with forward smash, down B, and Falcon punches. Like all kind of special moves.
And those are quite good if your opponent is not like in a reactionary playstyle.
Right.
So if your opponent is just sitting there and he sees you start up a Falcon punch, there's no way he gets hit by it, right? But if he's already sort of committed to coming in with a short hop aerial and you're just out of range, then that can be when these moves are on the best. Wow, that's very strange that up he did not hit Falcon. That dash attack against opponents at low percent, I think, is the number one thing that low-level players who are looking to get better should cut out of their game. Because it is just so easy to punish if they even just shield it. And that's going to be the game. Two 3-stocks in a row for Edward, so congrats to him moving on a little bit longer.
So now, I believe, are we in top 8?
We are not yet. So I was just talking to the tournament organizer, and the way this is going to work is we have 6 people coming out of these double elimination round robin pools to get into the top 8, and 2 people were seeded. So you were the 64 specialist who was seeded by winning the tournament. And then there was, I don't remember what they called it, like an Omnigamer or something. And he was a person who had achieved a high seed in the other Smash games and had done well in 64, and so they gave him the second seed. So he's sort of like the all-around Smasher.
Okay, cool.
Unfortunately, they can't get him on the phone right now. So it might be that 7 slots open up from these pools, in which case they're going to have a grudge match between the 2 people who are tied for 7th place.
Okay.
And we're going to do that on stream for the last seed. That'll be really interesting to watch if that happens. It does sound like most of... we have 4 people who have gotten out of pools so far. And so we need 2 more. And so they're running the loser side of these groups to figure out the last 2 people to get out. And then, like I said, maybe we'll have a 3rd person get out. Get that 7th slot.
So you and Daniel got the winners.
Daniel and I are out. There was also Eli over here who was playing the Blueberry Kirby. We saw him make it out. Surprisingly enough, neither Apathy nor Max have made it out yet. They're pretty deep in the loser side of the bracket, though, so they'll both have a chance to make it out, especially if there's a 7th place grudge match that they can play. So it looks like they're playing their match off stream right now, actually, which is too bad, because I think that would have been a great match, Apathy versus Max.
Oh, right.
But right now we have Ricky Smith pulling out the Mario against Edward, who we just saw last game beat that Fox player. See if Edward knows how to get around these forward smash and down Bs. And, good start so far for him.
Oh,
nice up B to get out of whatever hitbox Falcon was going to throw.
That is a great reactionary up B. Unfortunately, rolls into the forward smash. So roll is another move which I think is a great thing to cut out of your game as you're getting better. It does give you a little bit of invulnerability right at the beginning. That's why a lot of people like it, to bait out their opponent's attacks. But you actually have a ton of invulnerability, as we just saw there, near the end of the roll. So a lot of people will recommend you start using pivots instead, which is when you use your initial dash animation and then cancel it with a quick turnaround. And that'll get you about the same distance as a roll, but you're in control of your character the whole time, and it allows you to really easily bait your opponent and stuff and then punish them.
Alright, these two are even so far. So, quite a bit of rolling from Edward.
And he's got the descending tornado instead of the rising tornado there, which is pretty nice. That's actually a very interesting option against people who recover high, is that second hit of Falcon's forward air. It just has such good range, and, particularly against characters like Jigglypuff, and even sometimes Kirby, who like to stay really far away. It's a pretty good move to use, even if you don't hit them, just to bait out some of their jumps as they have to dodge them. If they're not willing to try to commit to beating you in the air. We have a little bit of a baby standard there, the single up air to up B. And that America's combo almost did it. Of course, with a rising tornado, Mario's going to be able to recover from down like that. But, ooh, a Falcon Punch in neutral is really going to shift the momentum. How do you come back from this? You just got Falcon Punch like that, and now you're down two stars. Sorry, I was talking to Abby earlier about the mental side of the game. When you make mistakes or something sort of embarrassing, like getting Falcon Punch happens to you, how do you maintain your cool? Is that something that you focus a lot on?
No, not really. I don't think I've really been in a situation where I felt like it was really throwing off my game.
Well, that's good.
It's good to be stone cold in the moment, at least.
Absolutely.
Your edge, no matter what.
Yeah, ideally it would just be great to have the mental fortitude to not worry about anything except for the stalk in front of you and the stalk in front of you.
Yeah, alright. I mean, that's where the great comebacks are made. When you're down three stocks and it's looking terrible, but you keep going, you're able to pull it out. That's always worth it.
That's right, yeah. Ricky gets a little bit of a punish on an attempt to Falcon Punch. And this Mario up B has really just been paying the bills for him. He's using a lot of times to get out of stuff that Edward's Falcon is doing. I would like to see a little bit of edge guarding from this Mario player, though. Something like a down smash on the edge, or even a down tilt. Even an edge hog,
Even a down air. I mean, you can take Falcon all the way to the blast zone and still make it back with
Mario. That's right. That's a real way to tilt your opponent. Did that a couple times in a row. A pseudo spike. And it looks like he heard us because he's just going for it. And unfortunately, he misses his up B. He didn't realize he had a second jump, perhaps. Being comfortable off stage is really one of the most important things to becoming a better player, I think.
Yeah, certainly. He's gonna switch to Fox. Didn't feel like it's Mario was doing it.
So maybe he just wants a little bit more speed in his dash and his run, his aerials, to try to not get hit by these slow special moves that Edward's throwing out.
We haven't seen a punish on Edward. Down B starts yet.
That's right, we saw a little bit of a baby punish there with the shield grab, but that's definitely something that'd be great. I mean, if you just hold shield while he's trying to go for it, you're gonna get the grab every time. The ending frames on that down B are just way too long. And And Edward's going for the hard read on these Falcon Punches. He really likes that as an option as opposed to something like the back row.
And the Fox, man. Just walked right into it.
So that will often happen. If you accidentally, we got something really nice started here.
Yeah.
That's a 5-hit combo, it looks like.
Ooh. Maybe if it was just a little further back.
So, I mean, a lot of time in this game, as you land after an aerial or after you forward thrown somebody, if you hold over on the thumbstick to try to run too quickly, then you'll just buffer and you'll just get that walk animation. And that's probably what we saw a few stocks ago from Whitney. Just walked into that forward swing. She was probably trying to run. But it looks like running's not going to help him because he gets hit by it again for his second stock. Two forward smashes, two stocks.
Misses the grab there, but he gets it there.
And that's exactly what I was talking about before. The dash attack into shield is just not safe at all. And Edward's just capitalizing beautifully on the stuff that he gets with these well-spaced forward smashes. That's three forward smashes and three stocks that Ricky's lost. And he really needs to figure out a way to get around them. Maybe bait it, and even rolling away is good enough. And once again, shield grab from that dash attack.
Fastball neutral air there.
That's what I like to see. And again, Ricky's getting punished for these dash attacks on shield so much.
Forward smash planks.
It looks like Ricky is doing a good job mixing up the angle of his box up to make sure he's not hit by these slow attacks that Edward's throwing out. But once he's on stage, he's just running into these forward smashes over and over. Edward's doing a great job getting this. And that's maybe a little greedy by Edward. And Ricky's going to capitalize on it. Falcon cannot recover from it. So I think Ricky really does have a chance here. If he gets a good punish, the laser probably meant to go the other direction. It's going great. And this could be it.
Pretty good.
He gets bug hug. And that's just unfortunate, because that run on forward air really could have been something. Little perfect land.
Making pretty good use of those forward tilts.
Yeah, he is. It looks
catching
like
Falcon out of
No, and that is a savage way to go out. Once again, last stock of both games, he doesn't realize he has a second jump and just gets pineapples by blue.
That's too bad.
So that's just too bad. So I've got to imagine we don't have too many more games in pools left. We're already in round 5, as you can see on your screen, in the losers half of the bracket. Okay.
So Rogan,
Alright, so we're just hearing now that Edward, the winner of that game, has made it into top 8, which is great. Congratulations to him. And it looks like we have 6 or 7 of our top 8 slots are locked in now.
Alright. So just one more. Just that grudge match between...
All right, so I'll give you guys an update. So we're basically at the point of the top 8. The Omnibus Award winner, Shane Johns, doesn't play 64 at all, so it looks like he's not going to make it tonight. So we're going to do a death match between the gentleman who just lost here and the loser of the match over between Max and Apathy to kind of figure who that last seventh slot's going to be.
Excellent.
So here we go. I think it might be Apathy. So it's Apathy versus Ricky, it looks like. So we'll do one more death match, and then we'll be taking a brief hiatus and break to reset the bracket and everything else. And both you gentlemen, along with 6 others, will enter into the top 8 of the Smash, the PRG 64.
Excellent. Right. Should be good. So it sounds like there's a game between Max and Apathy off stream, and that was to decide who gets to play this grudge match for the final top 8 slot. And unfortunately for Max, it looks like Apathy has won, so we'll see our boy back at it again with the Fox.
Yeah, I'm surprised. I actually would have thought that Max was going to take that.
I do want to talk to Max to see how those matches go. how this match went. Also, be nice to offer a little encouragement to him because he really is a great player, a lot of potential. And I think if he comes out and plays a little bit often, he could be a strong player for sure. And this
that was
is
close. Nice. But
it was a nice combo from Apathy, but maybe he didn't realize that he blew that double jump earlier trying to get that shine. So he SDs after a really nice combo.
Yeah, all he needed there was an up B to get back to stage. But
now, sometimes when you think you have a jump, you spend too long spamming that C button, and then by the time you realize,
yeah,
it's too late. And that was almost a great gimp from Ricky. That run off forward air can be really, really disastrous against people who are trying to recover low. And Apathy has just gotten over it twice. And perhaps Ricky will start noticing. So once again, this is the last match of groups, and the winner of this best of three is going to make it into top eight as the last slot. So this is a big match for both these players. And it's pretty much even. Slight percentage lead for Ricky. And that'll help actually a lot. Even though Mario is going for the gimps, you know, making sure you can get Fox pretty far away from stage and force him to use his up-beat, that goes a long way in this matchup.
Oftentimes I've seen Apathy doing an up tilt instead of like a jab to set up up smash. That's probably finishing stocks a lot better if you just jab to up smash.
That's right, yeah. We did see him get a nice up smash on, it wasn't really a true combo there on that side flat, but it did look like a little bit of option coverage. Right?
These up tilts.
The up tilts can be great, especially if you think your opponent is not going to DI much or at all. You can get a couple of them and really keep them in the air for a while. A lot of time you can also, even if they're not true, you can sometimes catch the startup frame from somebody's jump. And then they'll just only have their up B left when you finally do combo them off stage. I think, interestingly enough,
off stage.
Oh, that might be. It looks like Ricky didn't realize that his second jump was coming.
It's back throw. That's it for Fox.
That'll do it. If Ricky can get a quick dip here, he can really even up this first game. And I gotta say, in a best of three, possibly last game of the tournament, coming off to an early start in game one is gonna be really important for these two players. It's going to give you counter pick advantage later, although I don't think Apathy's going to switch off to Fox. I suppose we've seen his Falcon, though. And we did see Ricky's Fox, too, so maybe the counter pick might come up big.
Yeah, he is looking pretty comfortable with Fox at the moment, though.
Absolutely.
It's a nice up air he snuck in there, right as Mario was landing on the top platform.
Sorry, Fox has a really, really fast jump, and you can do some really cute things trying to throw off your opponent, since if you just use your single jump and go for that up air, you will not land on the top platform. But if you use both of your jumps, even if you spam them as quickly as you can, so that you're sort of second jumping from the ground, you will perfectly land on that top flat. So it's really hard for your opponent to know what to do out of shield, because they're not sure they're really going to be sure where you're going to land. And that's a big advantage Fox has.
Yeah. Looks like Mario isn't really sure what to do with all these Fox jumping around everywhere, throwing out back airs now.
Yeah, he really might be feeling overwhelmed by Apathy's pressure.
Yeah, that can definitely happen against Foxes who really have their movement down and they're all over the place.
Oh no, this could be bad. You're gonna get a big advantage if you shield that down beam. Fortunately for Ricky, he was too high percentage for that up smash to work out. And I think maybe a little tech error from that.
I think possibly an up air there would have been good to finish off the stop. Instead he went for the forward air to get him off stage. It works out in the end.
Absolutely. Apathy with that patented go deep off stage with Fox strategy. It pays off great for him this game. And he'll definitely have to be careful with that, not getting punished later on.
We're going to see a Fox ditto, it looks like.
This is the true test of skill. After Samus dittos, this is the best matchup we can do.
Apathy coming out the gate strong.
Wow, that is is going to be a very nice first one. He looks like he's really liking those short on down airs. And with the amount of DI that's coming out of Ricky, it's just a great option. Looks like he ate that jump again and taking two quick stocks. I gotta say, the short hop down air with Fox is actually one of the harder moves to see cancel, at least for me.
Yeah,
especially
I agree.
Especially because it's so hard to know if you're gonna hit shield, how many hits are gonna hit.
Actually, I think Yoshi's maybe a little harder for me at least.
Yoshi's what?
Yoshi's down air.
Oh yeah?
It's a little harder. That drill is a little harder for me to cancel.
Wow, and Apathy is just taking us everywhere. He's had two gimps and a nice off the top kill. He's really relying on his movement and his short hops, his ability to Z-cancel, and that's a great shine out of shield. Once he realizes he's messed up his shield pressure. It doesn't look like Ricky has much of an answer to all this pressure, but this could be a good edge guard. Predicts the jump with that down smash. That's a great read. And that is a savage. That was a really nice angle from Ricky, but the hedgehog from Apathy is just going to seal that stock. And we might be looking at a 5-stock to get Apathy in the top 8. That'd be a really nice swing of momentum there. Once again, dash attack into shields. Oh, and he doesn't do it. So maybe a shine would have been better.
The wrong box.
But did JV's count? I say yes. Looks like it doesn't matter. Oh, and that is a beautiful shine. What a great way to get it in top 8 for Apathy. And congrats to him coming out. Really showing that the melee tech can come over, right? So a note to all you melee players out there, come play 64, play Fox.
All right, so gentlemen, we're going to take a quick 10-minute hiatus, and then we'll be back with top 8. Both of you gentlemen are part of it, along with 6 others, including Apathy, who just got that 8-number-8 slot. So. We'll tell everyone here who's watching, we'll be back in just a moment, so stay tuned.